This is Pastor Richard, and you're watching Anchored in Christ, a vlog from St. Paul's Lutheran Church to know what we believe and why we believe it to be anchored in Christ's word for us. Now, it has been a little bit of a while since we have actually done any of these videos here at St. Paul's, but nonetheless, we're going to try to get back to the routine of covering our different texts for upcoming Sunday school lessons here at St. Paul's, not only for our Sunday school teachers, but also for the parents to understand these texts in order to teach them to their youth, as well as the parents to hear these wonderful texts for themselves as well. Now, before we jump into things, I just want to make a brief mention to Crucial Productions. A big thank you to them for producing these videos. To be quite honest, there'd be no way that I would have the time or the ability to get these videos produced and also released and populated through things such as YouTube and so forth. So thank you to them. If you have a chance after this video, I'd like to encourage you to go over to crucialproductions.org. I'll pull up their website to check it out here. And look around a little bit. Obviously, you'll see this is where Anchored in Christ videos are housed and taken care of. But they also have podcasts. They also have different Bible studies. In fact, they've been working on this wonderful project called Bible in 5. These videos are covering each book of the Bible in 5 minutes or less. It's a wonderful website, wonderful resource. And also, if you have a chance, if you would consider, maybe consider giving to help with the costs and expenses of Crucial Productions and the work they're doing over there. So a big thank you to Peter and the rest of the guys over at Crucial Productions. Crucialproductions.org, check them out. Great organization. Now, with that said, let's jump into things. We're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 17 here. Let me pull that up so we can actually read that text together. Matthew chapter 17, we read this. It's the transfiguration of Jesus. And it says this, "And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, 'Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make 3 tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah.' He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him.' When the disciples heard this, they fell on their face, and they were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, 'Rise and have no fear.' And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only." Now, when we look at this text, obviously, when we teach this to our youth, as well as contemplate for ourselves, it is a profound thing to see Jesus transfigured, to see him shining brightly like the sun, which really is a display of his divinity, that Jesus is not only fully man, but he's also fully God at the same time. He's the God-man who has come for us. Now, what we want to take also special note of is this, is Peter, when he sees this, he says to Jesus, "Hey, I'm going to build a couple tents." Now, if we think about it, if we were on that mountain as well, we'd want to build not only 3 tents, but 4, 5, or 6. We'd want to stay there because that is good to be in the presence of such divinity, of such power, and such gloriousness of Christ. And so Peter really wants to capture that moment, stay up there, to be up there with that glory. But what we want to take notice of is this, is that Jesus says, no, we must descend off that mountain. He tells Peter and shows in that text that they have to come down off that mountain. Now, why did they have to come down off that mountain? Why couldn't they stay up there? Well, you see, Jesus had a divine purpose. He came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. He must come off of that mountain to go towards Golgotha, to go to dark Gethsemane, to die on that cross for us. And so we see the glory of Jesus on that mountain, which we want to capture and be a part of. Indeed, it appeals to us as human beings. It appealed to Peter as well, but they had to come down off of that Mount of Transfiguration so that the God-man Jesus could go to that dark cross to die for all humanity. In fact, if you look at our text here, Jesus is talking to Moses and Elijah. Now, Elijah, he represents all the prophets, and Moses really captures the Torah. We think of the first 5 books of the Old Testament as Moses being the author of those first 5 books. So we see Christ talking with Moses and Elijah, the two big figureheads of the Old Testament, and they're visiting. Now, what are they visiting about? In the Gospel, Luke chapter 9, verses 30 through 31, we hear, get this is just profound. They're talking about the cross of Christ. Indeed, they're talking about the cross of Christ. In other words, we see Jesus fully transfigured. We see his divinity, his power, his gloriousness on that Mount of Transfiguration, like Peter. And Peter says, we want to capture this. We want to stay here. This is wonderful. This is profound. And yet, what is Christ talking about? He's talking about the upcoming cross where he must descend into that darkness to be forsaken by God the Father, to bear the sin of humanity, to be stretched out, to bleed and die on that cross, saying the words, "It is finished," to finish sin, the condemnation of sin, to finish the devil, to finish death itself. So as we teach this text, as we consider this text, we want to hit the transfiguration, the gloriousness of Jesus, his divinity on the top of that Mount Transfiguration. But we also must point to the fact that he's coming off of that mountain to go to Mount Calvary. He's coming off that mountain for the mission, the purpose of bleeding and dying and then ultimately rising. For who? For you and for me. Ah, great news. Great, great text to consider and to contemplate. So hit the transfiguration, hit the fact that Peter wanted to maintain and keep that glory, but we must hit the fact that they are talking about the cross. Jesus, Moses, and Elijah are talking about the cross, and that Jesus must come off of that Mount Transfiguration because he must go to the cross. Why? He must do it for us, to serve us, to give himself up as a life, his life as a ransom for you and for me. He must bleed and die to rescue us. So there you have it. Hope that helps. And we'll catch you next time.